This is LeetCode 941, Valid Mountain Array. I'm going to take you through a detailed breakdown of my thought process for solving it, and I really like this problem because everyone should be able to come up with a solution on their own. There are no prerequisites beyond just very basic programming, but the problem still has a bit of challenge to it. I always start with carefully reading the question text. Given an array of integers r, return true if and only if it's a valid mountain array. Recall that r is a mountain array if and only if, and it's kind of silly to use the word recall because where would I have seen this before? But anyway, they provide a definition below, and I know it's tempting to skip these technical descriptions, but it's really important to carefully analyze them because the examples usually don't provide a complete picture. And I try to make sense of things by rephrasing the question in my own words. The first requirement, simple enough, there are at least three elements. And then after digesting this section, here's what I see in my head. There must be an index I in the middle of the array, so not the first and not the last, that comes from this part here. As you move from index 0 to I, the values must be strictly increasing. That means every element must be bigger than the previous one. That's this bullet. And then as you move from index I to the end, the values must be strictly decreasing. That means every element must be smaller than the previous one. That's this bullet. And then they give us a few drawings to illustrate this idea. In the first drawing, we do have a valid mountain array. From the start to 5, the array is strictly increasing, and then from 5 to the end, it's strictly decreasing. In the second drawing, the left side is not strictly increasing. Remember, to be strictly increasing, every element must be bigger than the previous one, but here, 3 is not bigger than 3, so we return false. To simplify things, here's the picture that I now see in my head. So to be valid, you have to have this situation. The left side of the mountain is strictly increasing, and then the right side of the mountain is strictly decreasing. What characterizes the left side, of course, is that every element is bigger than the last. What characterizes the right side is that each element is smaller than the last. And then when you draw it out, you can also clearly see this peak in the middle. And that peak is characterized by being bigger than what's to the left and to the right. And in a valid mountain array, it will be the only element that will have this characteristic. Now let's look at the examples. In example 1, you have to have at least 3 elements, so we don't have that, we return false. In example 2, from 3 to 5, we ascend, but then we flatline, which is not allowed. You have to either strictly ascend or strictly descend. You can't ever flatline, so we return false. In example 3, we ascend from 0 to 3, which is good, so the left side is strictly ascending. We peak at 3, and then we strictly descend down to 2 and then down to 1, and so the right side is strictly descending. And we have our peak in the middle, so we return true. So how do we approach the problem? I want to revisit the conceptualization we had earlier, represented by this picture. The left side has to be strictly ascending, and the right side has to be strictly descending, and then we have our peak in the middle. If an input has these three parts, it's valid, otherwise it's not. So what if we had just searched for these three things? And if we search for the peak first, then we can neatly split the array into the three parts, the left side, the right side, and then the peak in the middle. So let's go ahead and outline the strategy in a little more detail. So first, I want to look for the first peak if there is one. If there isn't, then we can go ahead and return false because we're missing this requirement. Next, assuming there is a peak, then we've split the mountain into the left side and the right side, and we can check the left side. So check the left side, and of course, we're gonna check to make sure that it's strictly increasing. And then finally, we just check the right side to make sure that it's strictly decreasing. And if we get here, if we've passed all these checks, then we can return true. This approach is super simple and flows almost directly from analyzing the problem statement. And it did take some work to conceptualize the problem though, and to come up with this picture. So it's important that we did that. If we didn't, for example, if I had just leaned on the very technical problem statement here and had this in my head, I might not see this approach. Now, really quickly, let's consider the performance, so the time and space complexity. For time, this will be O of n. That's because we'll go through the array once to find the first peak, and then one more time to check the two sides in the worst case. And then for space, it will just be O of 1. It's because we're not really storing anything along the way as we go through the array. Now that we've fully worked out the logic and understand why it works, let's move on to implementation. So our first task is to look for the first peak. We're going to set it to none to start, since we don't even know if we're going to have one. And then we have to look at every index where there could be a peak. So for I in range, and then we have to think hard about what this range will be. So you can't have a peak at index 0 because the peak needs an element, or at least one element, to the left and the right. So you can't start at 0, so we just start at 1. And then we can't go to the last index like we would do here, because the last index doesn't have any element to the right side. So we want to do the second to last index. Now that we're looking at all the indices where there could be a peak, we need to think about how we're going to identify that. Remember, a peak needs to be bigger than what's to the left and bigger than what's to the right. So let's write that out. So if the current element is bigger than what's to the left, so that would be array I minus 1, and array I is bigger than what's to the right, so that would be array I plus 1, then we've identified a peak. So if we get this condition, then we have a peak, so we have to record it. So I'll say our first peak is at I, and then we can break. And then after we've done this work, we can think about whether we've actually fulfilled this requirement of having a peak. So if our first peak is none at this point, then we can return false right away because there's no peak in the input. So I'm just going to add a comment here. If no peak, then it's invalid, so we return false. And then we need to check the left side. We want to check to make sure that the left side is strictly ascending. So for I in range, and I'll go from 0 up to first peak. And then we want to check all of the adjacent pairs. So if anything is not strictly increasing, then we'll return false. So if not, array I is less than the next one, I plus 1, then we can return false because we know something on the left side is not strictly increasing. Now we have to do almost the same thing on the right side. So for I in range, and I'll start at the first peak, and we want to try to go to the end. You'll see how the indices work out, but I'll go to length of array minus 1, because we're going to look at each index after I. And so I want to end on the second to last index. All right, so we're going to look at the pairs. So if anything is not strictly decreasing, so if not the current element is greater than the next one, or I plus 1, then we can return false right away. So return false. And then finally, if we pass all of these checks, then we can just return true. So let me change this into code, and we're done. So let me just get rid of this to clean things up a little bit so we can hopefully see everything on the same page. And there you have it. That's the implementation for our first strategy. And then I'll submit, and we can see that it works. When I solved the problem, I came up with this approach where we looked for a peak and then checked both sides. But there's another popular approach, and personally, I think it's a lot harder to think about, and the implementation is really easy to mess up. To come up with this new strategy, you could imagine that you're going to climb the mountain yourself, but in a really specific way. And it was helpful for me to imagine that I had programmed a robot that can only reach the end of valid mountain arrays. That means the robot would start by strictly ascending for as long as possible to scale the left side of the mountain. And then after that, it would strictly descend for as long as possible to come down the right side of the mountain. The reasoning is that if the robot ascended, descended, and reached the end, then that would only happen on valid mountain arrays. And we know that because it means it went up a strictly ascending left side, and then it went down a strictly descending right side. That's literally all it can do. It feels like this will work, but how can we be sure? Well, let's just think through all the possibilities. First, we don't need to worry about flatlining. That's because the robot can only ascend or descend. So if it hits a flatline, it will just get stuck. It won't reach the end and will return false, no problem. So at the start, now that we can safely ignore flatlining, we only need to think about three cases: ending right away, starting with an ascent, or starting with a descent. If we end right away, which means there's only one number in the array, we'll reach the end without having ascended or descended, so we'll catch that case and return false. Now let's talk about the descent column, because it's a little bit simpler than the ascent column. So if we descend right away, the array will look like this. The robot will attempt to ascend for as long as possible, which is not at all, and then it will fully descend. And we'll be doomed for failure though, because once you've descended, there's no way you'll be able to ascend again. Now, the last case, what if we begin with an ascent? If that happens, the robot will ascend as much as it can until something changes, which can be one of two things. We either end or we descend. If we end, then we will have finished without having descended, and so we can return false. If we descend and then end, we will have ascended, we will have descended, and we will have reached the end, so we'll correctly return true. If we have the same situation, but instead of stopping right here, we do an ascent, we'll catch that because the robot will get stuck down here. Because once it starts descending, it can never ascend again. These cases are pretty hard to think about because you have to be extremely methodical. If you don't fully think it through though, you might have this sinking feeling that it doesn't quite make sense. And that's protective because it can push you to think about it harder. So now you probably understand why I'm not the biggest fan of this approach. When I saw this problem and found that this was the most popular solution, it really upset me because the last one was so much more straightforward because we could just explicitly check for the three requirements of the problem. I'll start the implementation with two variables, ascended and descended. That way we can track if the robot actually did these two things. And then we want to start the robot at index 0. So we'll set I equal to 0. And now we want the robot to ascend for as much as it can. So as long as there is a next element, so while I plus 1 is within the bounds of the array, so length of array, and the current and the next element is ascending, so that's ri is less than ri plus 1. While that's true, we want to, of course, mark ascended as true. And then we want to move the robot forward, so we'll increase I by 1. And then we want to do almost the same thing for the next part. So the next part is, now that we've done the ascending, we want to descend for as much as possible. So while there is a next element, this part is the same. And while the current element and the next one are descending, so we'll just have to flip this to greater than, then we'll mark descended as true, and we'll move the robot forward. And then finally, our last step is we just need to check for three things. We need to check that the robot ascended and descended, and it reached the end. So we'll return a Boolean expression. We'll check that it ascended and descended and it reached the end. We can do that by seeing that I is at the last index. So I is equal to length of the array minus 1. Now we can go ahead and submit, and we can see that it works. Now let's do our time and space complexity analysis. So we'll do time and then space, and it's really the same thing as the previous solution. So we've O of n, because in the worst case, we're gonna go through the entire array. And then for space, we've O of 1, because we only have 3 variables, ascended, descended, and I. And so it's the same performance as the previous solution.